Thank you very much, and this great opportunity to talk to not only mathematicians but physicists. And you know much better than me what is Yang-Baxter equation and why there were two Nobel Prizes for things related with them. If you think about general goal of this, is first to define homology for every Yang-Baxter operator or even pre-operator. Invertibility is not needed in definition. And the goal is to connect this to Hovanov homology. And in particular, I will compute some example, maybe compute, give result of some computations for Yang-Baxter operator, which is giving Jones polynomial and Homfli polynomial, substitutions in Homfli polynomial. Connection is not yet obtained, except connection on the level of Euler characteristic. One is giving Jones polynomial, and second has Euler characteristic Jones polynomial. So let's start from the very elementary introduction, I would say, for physicists, but maybe not. Maybe this more just elementary introduction. So I was told that Misha was introducing Fox tree colorings in his talk last time. So I draw coloring. We color every crossing using tree colors. Either all of them have the same color, so this is allowed, or all three different colors. Yeah, this blue and green are very similar, but they're different. So all three colors are allowed. So this is kind of our baby example how homology can be built, and finally we'll reach Fox tree coloring is the simplest, non-trivial for me, Yang-Baxter situation, not yet equation. So let's start from examples. So we consider diagrams of knots, and we can try to naively build invariants of knots, very, very naively. I don't like to talk too much about this, so let's say already our diagrams have orientation. So this is positive crossing, oriented, and very naively what we'll do, we'll choose some set and color arcs of the diagram. Initially motivated by fundamental group or some other topological consideration, we give the same symbol here and here. Of course, it's not that good, but historically the first homology theory was developed using this assumption. So let's do it naively. So here will be color A, here color B. As I said, for a moment, we assume that here is color B, and here some color. We don't like arbitrary color, so we treat this as operation. So our set is really magma with binary operation. And here we go by this magma. So this is the rule of colorings. And we count how many colorings we have. Of course, because already I put orientation, we have to do something similar for negative crossing by our convention. So let's draw, maybe not, let me draw such. Some of you will see immediately that I have in mind second Rademeister move. So if here are colors, let's say B, D, then this oriented. Then, because it's here we use our operation, so here we have used another operation. So it will be again B is going true, and here will be D, this other operation. What was here? D, B. B acting on D. Anyway, that's the rule of colorings of oriented diagrams. And then, what is invariant of the diagram? We'll kind of follow. So first of all, we can just say naively, every crossing is colored according to these rules. This is number of colorings. So here, for a moment, we have independently second operation for negative crossing. So we just count number of colorings. Colorings X using these operations of the diagram D. And we can ask what condition this operation should satisfy to have invariant of link. It should be invariant, we know. So maybe for physics I should mention that Rademeister moves are really first considered by Maxwell in 19th century, except he didn't publish anything. So, but he clearly understood the move on the diagram which preserves nothing in space. So, very shortly, first level Meister move, I will not even put orientation, it's required that color is always the same. So the first rule for not torus, I will ignore this rule later, idempotence. Of course we have to consider orientation, etc. Second move, I draw here. So when we go here, then we continue, this you can undo. Which means that if I take, I wrote this D, but really this means that A star B star B is equal to A. This was in my picture, was called D. That is A star B. So then we can do second Rademeister. This I will partially ignore today as well, but not totally. But this is orientation parallel. And finally, the third Rademeister move, and for very easy, but for people who didn't see this, I will do calculation, what we should do about star, so the third Rademeister move is giving the same color at the end. So I will use this picture several times, so it should be big. So I'm drawing this so every crossing is positive, then it's easier to do things. You will not see if it's here. Maybe that's okay. So I'm writing second, third Rademeister move in the braid form. Okay. So this is braid relation or third Rademeister move, and let's do this. So we like this number of colorings by our operation, by our magma, to be invariant under these moves. Our rule are saying that we go from the top to bottom, coloring is unique, so only reason is, only goal is that the colors here and here will end the same. So, so C is going over the top, so always C. B is going only under C, so it is B star C. B star C. So only interesting here is the third branch, so A is going under B, A star B, and then going under C. So here is A star B star C. And here A is going under C. Here B is going under C. So eventually we get A star C going under B star C. So clearly we are forced to assume right self-distributivity. So first condition, second, third condition, A star B star C equal A star C star B star C. So this was probably first discovered by Conway and Wright, but it was first written and really explained by Joyce in his PhD thesis in 79. And independently Matvieff, more or less the same time. And Joyce is calling object, algebraic object with either two operations, one inverse to another, because we can say that this inverse to this, or I should write both of them, because otherwise you can write these moves like this as well. So star and star bar are inverse one to another, in a sense, like this. And Joyce called this object quantum. Today, as I said, I will ignore mostly first move, then the object. So quantum satisfy 1, 2, and 3. When we ignore first move, then, so take only 2 and 3, it is called rack. Rack should be rack. This is the original name of Conway, by Conway. And if it only satisfies right self-distributivity, sometimes it's called shelf. algebraists was considering this much before, and natural name for them was LSD, but they decided that is not a good name. We have a light distributivity, so it will be no problem, but still we call this shelf on the axiom tree. So first I will build homology for this, but for people who guess already how I will lead to Yang-Baxter operator, let's notice that we can think about this crossing and we can think that really we have R working on X times X into X times X. Just this is going true, which means that R A B is equal B A star. A star B. So this operator on X times X satisfied Tertrademeister move, so we can guess that it will be Yang-Baxter or pre-Yang-Baxter operator, Yang-Baxter operator. Of course, then we should treat X as the basis of space. Okay, but this will be later. So, what about homology? Now I'd like to spend some time devising, or maybe examples. So there are maybe three important examples, which I maybe mentioned today, of just Quandl. The basic example and the reason for the name given by Conway, Rack, is that really conjugation in group satisfies all axioms. So there's N group, and we define A star B equal B inverse AB. And the second automatically inverse will be BAB inverse. So this is the first typical example, and just to say a little historically, really such objects were first, almost such objects were considered by Takasaki in 1942. Not much is known about Takasaki, so if you can find something, would be good. He was probably a student of Japanese mathematician called Toyoda, but disappeared in Manchuria in 1945. So Takasaki was considering abelian group. Maybe it should be here. G abelian. And his operation was A star B, so it's abelian, so additive notation 2A minus B. This is really, if abelian group is Zn, this is really this Fox coloring. Especially if n is equal to 3, this is really Fox coloring. So twice bridge minus the tunnel. So just to say anecdote for people who like to know, how to generalize this operation into any group. Of course, conjugation is not directly generalization of this. So Takasaki was trying. Paper is in old Japanese, so I cannot say for sure, but there are kind of partial translations. So Takasaki was trying. And when you look at his paper, he was trying A star B, so how to raise this. A square B inverse didn't work, doesn't satisfy distributivity. He was trying B inverse A square. Both of them are not right distributive. What is the proper answer, which was found only later? Not really by Joyce, but Joyce is listing this. What will work? Of course, there's only one natural, more natural choice. Put B inverse in between. So real operation is A star B is equal B A inverse B. And very easy to check that satisfy distributivity and all axioms of a quandl. This, on the other hand, for topologists and for physicists probably as well, it is interesting that this really, when you decorate diagram by A and B and use this operation, it will lead to fundamental group of double branch cover. So this is again related to fundamental group, but you have to take double branch cover. I think Oleg can tell interesting anecdote. It was really discovered by his student. But Oleg, as was then prevalent, was 60-something, yeah? Every invariant was supposed to come from fundamental group. So he told students that, he will tell better this, but can ask him later. He told students that it cannot be interesting, must somehow follow some fundamental group. And then he taught a little, and next day he proved that it is a fundamental group of double branch cover. And student didn't publish, and later was big paper by Wada, I think, that this is giving fundamental group of double branch cover. Anyway, 20 years later. So the moral was not to ignore students' questions. Okay, so this is this example. And finally, the next example, which I will mention today, is to do kind of affine algebra out of this. We call this Alexander Quandl. So we take G is a group again, but there's action on G, so T automorphism of the group. So otherwise, G is Z of T module. We need inverse as well. So. And then our operation will be A star B is equal to T B plus 1 minus T. TA, 1 minus TB. Kind of affine relation. So I will show a few results about computation for this specific Quandl, because they are, at least this is new. Okay. So having few examples, let's define homology initially of Quandl. There are plenty of possibilities, so this definition is nicely giving some not invariants, or more generally invariants of codimension to embedding in Sn. Okay, so let's erase all this and definition of homology. So maybe some names first before I erase this. So this was first done by Fenn. Rudk and Sanderson. Starting from 1990. plus. It was slowly developing. Now we know Fenn retired and he wrote paper and he said, idea came to me April 2nd, 1990. And then he wrote a letter to Rudk. And then it was developed, and this invariants of Link developed, cocycle, as we call them, invariants. Our main people are Carter, Kamada, and Saito. And it's about 1998. Okay, so with this, let me prepare ground. It would be nice to compare definition to homology of groups, because definitions are very similar. Just associativity is exchanged by distributivity. But one has to be careful, and this is the reason that it was discovered, first of all, pretty late, and secondly, motivated by knot theory. Let's do this purely for distributivity. So assume that X is a shelf. So write self-distributive. So for a moment, let's give definition. So we build chain complex. Cn, like in the case of group homology, will be, let's say, over Z, Z X to power n. Then bundle operation. let's say people call this luck, even if it's on the shelf needed. But let's write luck for a moment here, will be equal the alternating sum of alternating sum of phase maps. But like in cube, will be bottom and top, or I prefer to say left and right. So d I l minus d I right. So this is the setting which very often we meet in homology theory. Alternating sum of phase map, but phase map are top and bottom, left and right. And now we have to define what they are. In this specific case, they are very easy, especially left one, DIL, is just deleting I term, like for simplicial complexes. But let's write this carefully, because I will refer to this definition when we go to Yang-Baxter operator. So it is x1, xi minus 1, xi plus 1, xn. So this is this easy one. No, left, oh, sorry, right is easy one. Because I draw picture, so it will be right. It doesn't matter really, but for me it's right. And left is here, right is here, okay. And left one will be just interesting. Namely, we take I element and project on everything before. In group homology, we glue to the neighbor. Here, we glue to everything before. Okay, so this will be equal x1 star xi will xi minus 1 star xi xi plus 1 xn. So we check that this is a chain complex. Maybe still write this R. But we check much more, and it is very useful to know what we are checking. So maybe here I don't show, maybe physicists are more familiar than some mathematician, but we almost see here the structure of pre-cubic set. So what it means? It means that di l, not l, some epsilon, because either l or r. So epsilon dj some delta is equal to dj minus 1 delta di epsilon for I less than j. For simplicial complex, these are obvious conditions. But this is kind of saying how phases works with when you take boundary. So if you forget about these indices, you have just simplex and boundary of the boundary, you change order, so you should get the same thing, and sign is only put here to differentiate. But that's very important. So let's call this pre-cubic. Pre-cubic because we don't have degeneracy. Pre-cubic. So this isn't pre-cubic set. So for people who didn't see this, let's write formally axioms of pre-cubic category or pre-cubic module or pre-cubic set. It's essentially what is written here. So first of all, I was trying to find who was first to define this. And of course, it is kind of analog of Eilenberg-MacLane pre-simplicial and simplicial sets. But I was told that it is first described precisely in PhD thesis of Jean-Pierre Serre, so early 50s. Anyway, pre-cubic, it will be almost a repetition of this example, pre-cubic set, or maybe category, because I will use module or set, so category. So we fix our category. Then, for every positive n, we take set of objects. So maybe I should write it differently. For every n greater or equal than 1. Objects. And then we have n plus 1 morphisms. We have morphisms, I'm saying wrongly, twice n, because there's plus and minus. So there are morphisms, di, from xn into di epsilon, from xn to xn minus 1, and should be 2n of them, yeah? So it should be from 1 to n. We should think that we have cube, and these morphisms are just sides of the cube. And so we have object, we have morphism, and they have to satisfy this condition. Such that it is totally relevant here. You have concrete definition, but it's good to have a general thing. Such that di epsilon dj delta equal dj minus 1 delta di epsilon. Did I wrote it here the opposite? No, the same. For I less than j. So maybe one comment, however, for a moment, interesting only from historical point of view. So here it was, category was category of sets, because we have xn, and operation was going from xn to xn minus 1, always. When we have presimplicial, precubic set, it is very nice because it's natural geometric realization. You can, this is really, it's like in Eilenberg style. These are names. These are names of cubes, and this is instruction how to glue them together. And object you get, we have the same homology as this abstract thing. I didn't say what are homology. Homology we define by the same formula. Chain complex is this. So I said left, right, 0, 1, doesn't matter, epsilon, delta. So van der N is defined or if this is module, of course, not category. Di, di epsilon, di, I wrote left first, left I minus di, I right. Okay. So then it's chain complex and we have homology, cubic homology. So historically it was like this, that Fenn, Rook and Sanderson first thought, or Fenn maybe, first thought about some cubic object associated to knots. And only then he took homology of this. And then, of course, they algebraized this and have purely algebraic definition like this. Okay. So now we'll be step toward Yang-Baxter. For this, and this is the reason it was not discovered before, is that we need very, that if you have very nice picture describing this homology, then you are done, you know, Yang-Baxter will be just pictographic generalization. But if you don't have, you don't have. This reason that even for set theoretical Yang-Baxter equation, when here was some a, b, and here not b is not necessarily b, so it is just R1, a, b, R2, a, b. It took some time to define homology in this easy situation, not linear combination, but just they go through. Now we call this, after people learn, set theoretic Yang-Baxter operator, this going from AB to this. But then it was kind of naively considered. Anyway, Carter, Kamada, and Saito with student defined homology, very complicated way for this. And it happened to be what I describe now as easy thing. So what we don't need. So this will be the most important. Everybody can reconstruct homology after this picture. So let me erase this, you know, cubic. So picture is as follows. Let's first start with this left one, which is really the important thing here. We take our strings. This is I, because I will define DIL graphically. So I will take I strings. So they are decorated. Maybe I should write this decorated by XI, this is X1, this is XN, etc. We take this and go to the left, which I call this left, and disappear. You see, this is exactly the definition of DIL. We operate here, so this is going just always XI, but if here was XI minus 1, here XI, so for example, here it will be X1 star XI, etc., etc., exactly as in definition. So when you have such picture, no problem, instead of doing distributivity and something like this, just decorate this by Yang-Baxter operator and you have homology. But now I will be slow. So if you know, you know. What about the second easy part? Easy part is too easy maybe to interpret, but proper interpretation is that we take this and you take I, but it got on the bottom here and disappear. So you see, in our model, nothing happened. XI disappear, but nothing is modified because it's on the bottom. But of course, for general Yang-Baxter operator, it will be another Yang-Baxter operator here. I draw everything that is only positive crossing, so really Yang-Baxter, really operator. So this will be definition later. So this is right. DL. So I will dwell on this picture later. For a moment, let's go back to distributivity. Just to show some calculations which were made. Okay, so let me erase all this. So let's first consider first non-trivial example. Fox colorings, or maybe more generally, Takasaki of group ZN. So just to, it's usually called RN. I don't like this because it's mixed later with Yang-Baxter operator, but anyway, ZN. I remember definition was A star B is equal to B minus A. So, first was really conjecture. So we did a lot of calculation with my student Maciej Niebrzydowski. So his name should be here. I'm slightly cheating because it will be this reduced version divided by degenerates. But I'm writing on the results. So conjecture was that for n odd, so this will be Quandl homology. So this is just standard homology divided by degeneracy somehow defined. Anyway, there are equivalence to all this. So of Rn is equal. First, maybe I should do this exercise, but it is always number of connected components, so it's not so interesting. N equal 1. But then it is Zn odd. Zn to power fn, n greater than 1. And conjecture, which we check for many numbers, was that fn is what I called, we called the late Fibonacci number. So Fn, F first initial condition F1 equal F2 equals 0, and F3 equal 1, and Fn equal Fn minus 1 plus Fn minus 3. So kind of, like we call this delay Fibonacci, because instead of previous one is lambda. So this conjecture happened to be true, and it was proven for, not totally, but for n prime number. So independently by Takas, by Nosaka and Clauvens. It is yes for n prime number. Different than 2, of course. Prime number. Odd prime number. So this was the first highly non-trivial calculation by Nosaka and Clauvens. So what to make out of this? Homology even for Zn, kind of coming from Zn, is growing exponentially, because one could expect that there is some periodicity like homology of groups of Zn. Still, I think there is periodicity, and slogan should be that we should take logarithm of this and then it will be periodic, something. I have no clue. But must be some regularity. But anyway, this is the first non-trivial result in general homology of these objects. Second result, I think, nice, and it was generalized a few weeks ago, so it's for second homology, but for of any Takasaki quantum of odd number of elements first. So second theorem, again, Maciej Nieprzytowski. So the second, even when it was that if G finite odd abelian group, odd number of elements, then second, only second this time, second homology of this Takasaki quandl of this group, and remember, the definition is the same. In abelian group is 2b minus a is, and then nice surprise for us, just wedge of g and g. So I didn't realize immediately when we published this paper, but when you think about this, people, specialists, know that, and using slogan they use, Schur multiplier group of such G is exactly this. But Schur multiplier for finite abelian group, for finite group, I think is just second homology. So it is known that second homology of G with standard coefficients is exactly G wedge G. So it is not accident. Not accident, but still there are various theorems connecting homology of group with homology of quantum related, but none of them is computable or nice in our sense. Nothing like this that is exactly the same. Okay, next example. This I would like to keep for a moment. Second is for Alexander Quandl. We try to do the same for a similar thing for Alexander Quandl. So maybe before I even go to this, one more word about first homology. Just for language reasons. So that's good to remind definition. So what is bundle 2 of A, B for any quantum or any distributive structure? Right, distributive. So this should be sum from 1 to 2. But really, the first term always reduces in our setting. So if you apply definition, we are left only with A, minus A star B. So immediately we see that we have action on the quandelon itself, and element of the orbits are equivalent in first homology. So H1, maybe let's write into steps, is equal Z of X divided by A minus A star B, something related by this relation. So this is equal just Z and then orbits. I don't know how to write orbits of our quanta. So right orbits. So the next result I will formulate only for connected quandals, meaning there's only one orbit. But this is purely technical because I work with Alexander Quandl, so assumption will be much easier to formulate differently. Okay, so theorem. So in weaker form, it was already proven by Clauvens. But this form which I will write is work with Nosaka and my students. So this is kind of new. It is, in a sense, it is minor generalization of this, but not really. I should list the name, but there's many, so I don't like to make mistake in the names. Okay, so what is this? So let X be an Alexander Quandl, and additionally 1 minus t, so this is this operator, t is operating on x and this operating on x as well, is invertible. Well, we can say equivalently 1 minus t x is equal to x. Then second homology of this X, of this Alexander Quandl, is equal. We start like here. We take X wedge. Maybe I will write tensor product. Wedge will be followed, but I prefer to write like this, stressing that is over Z. Like not over Z of T, but over Z. Divided. First, it is exterior algebra. So AA is 0. And then just action is trivial. So TA, TB is the same as AB. And that's it. So exterior algebra and action is trivial. This allows to compute many concrete examples. So Clauvens did slightly differently. He was not going through exterior algebra, but it was equivalent, as we prove is equivalent. But our proof is very combinatorial, very elementary. Doesn't matter. I should praise my students. So what more? Maybe finally let's go to Yang-Baxter operator, even if almost everything is done. So this I would like to keep. These calculations are not needed. Or maybe something should be said. I'm concentrating here on torsions mostly, finite group, this are torsion, etc., etc. So free part was totally computed for finite quandl. Free part was computed by I think, Etinkov and Grania, or maybe Grania Andruszkiewicz, I forget. They have several papers, but it's totally computed and not interesting. Depends only on the number of orbits. Proof is not, in general case, not so easy, but it is topological, not that interesting. Torsion is very interesting. And maybe even before I go to Yang-Baxter, just one word about how Carter, Kamada, and Saito define invariant of links from second cohomology. I prefer homology, so let's say homological invariant. So for every crossing, first of all, we consider all possible colorings. So this is Quandl K, so it is A, B, B, A star B. Then for positive crossing, we take A and B. For negative, A and B as well, but should be properly drawn, so I don't like to do this, but very, very schematically. A and B is element of X squared. So it is sum two chain. This two chain, when we add this, AB, for positive AB, otherwise should be some sign related to crossing. This happened to be not only chain, but cycle. And what Carter and Kamada and Saito noticed, it is invariant. They didn't know about homology, so they kind of started to reconstruct homology that they wanted to be invariant on the iterator. The Meister moved this sum. And they found that condition is as Rürken, Fenn, and Sanderson gave in their definition of homologies. So anyway, I should not go far, but more or less what we do, for every crossing we take pair, in positive crossing, pair which is coming to the crossing and add them, and this is potential invariant as well later for Yang-Baxter operator. So what they did, kind of simpler, is just to say take some fixed two cocycle to something, to A, some abelian group, and this will be invariant, this sum over. It's better to have universal one when you take cycle. Anyway, let's go finally to Yang-Baxter, which is almost done. Okay, so let's do very naively again. We have crossing, let's draw positive one, and we have set, and we try to color. Now don't do any restrictions. Before we have kind of coming from fundamental group restriction that is going over, or even if there's not this restriction, we said this has defined, this should be defined. No, just color A, color B, color C, color D, and say what is probability that it happen, rather what is weight that it happen. In some ring. So maybe before I will write more, let's still look at coloring, Fox or Quandl coloring. It was A, B, B, A, star B. How our invariant was formed? It was just number of allowed colorings. But what is allowed coloring? Instead of just saying that you have to color like this, you can put here weight, weight of the crossing. Weight of the crossing will be zero if coloring is not allowed, and weight will be one if it is allowed. Then if you like to have global coloring, then you should take product of all weights over all crossings. And if this is at least in one place is not allowed. It is not allowed, so it is zero. But if everywhere is one, it is one. And now we count them, so we just sum over all colorings. So already Fox coloring or Quandl coloring, naively we can describe as the sum over all colorings, product of weights, Boltzmann, whatever weights. So this will be just purely generalization of this sum. So what we consider will be product over all crossings of our weights. And of course, it should be sum over all colorings, because ABCD is coming from coloring. And we can ask when this is invariant under Rademeister moves. So first Rademeister move I will ignore, however one should not really ignore, but you can delay. And what about second and third Rademeister move? So just one word about second Rademeister move, even if homology ignores this. So what second Rademeister move is saying? So maybe, of course, I said second Rademeister move, but it was only for positive crossing. But for negative crossing, we'll do the same. That kind of write not maybe nicely, CD, EF, will be just another number. CD, EF. So it's kind of interesting, because when set theoretical invariants were introduced, meaning that you can change number here, but uniquely, there were very complicated formulas for agreement, for especially for third Rademeister move, when in fact solution was known and was obvious. So let's do it generally. This you know better than me. This is just coding for operator. So this is just coding. So let V will be in our space over X, and this is just coding of the map from V tensor V into V tensor V, and using this language, this is just entry of the matrix in the basis, so R of A, B will be the sum over C, D, R, A, B, C, D, C, D. Maybe I should write here a tensor product, but I'm used to write per. So this is just, this notation is just coding for such map. So there's no need to make some complicated formula, it's just simple linear algebra. We put here operator R, here we put the second one, R, and it should be the same as identity, which means that what I wrote here is R, R equal identity. And if I write this, the opposite will be R, R. So second Rademeister move, when we go along orientation is parallel, is just saying that our operator should be invertible. And most of you know what happened with third Rademeister move, but let's draw a picture, and I will use this picture several times. So obviously, we start from ABC, here we use R, here we do nothing, here we do nothing, use R identity, and of course here it's opposite. Okay. So obviously here we got Yang-Baxter operator. If you go from top to the bottom, I would like to have the same result. Then we need composition. Obviously, it has to satisfy Yang-Baxter equation. So third Rademeister move, you can say that the third Rademeister move should be, as it is written here, should be exactly as it's drawn here, meaning every crossing is positive. But using second Rademeister move, you can have all possibilities of third Rademeister move. Anyway, this is important. So R3 move corresponds to Yang-Baxter equation. In other words, when we have this naive weight for every coloring, then condition for second Rademeister move, parallel second Rademeister move, and third Rademeister move is invertibility and Yang-Baxter equation, so R should be Yang-Baxter operator. So, first Rademeister move needs some balancing. So this is the point of view taken by Turayev very early after new invariant of leaks were developed. He was taking Yang-Baxter operators from representation theory, mostly using paper of Jimbo and Baxter book, and producing various solution, various invariants of leaks constructed in this way, and balancing later for first Rademeister. So it is Turayev. But really the method was first noticed by Jones. Jones was very, very much likely to have kind of statistical mechanics approach to Jones polynomial. So he was really the first person to discover this. Jones. However, he, in a sense, approach using braids, like here, is simpler. And more important, does not require checking second Rademeister move when you go in the opposite direction. And this is a big thing. In knot theory, you can confirm that people, instead of using Yang-Baxter, using biquandle, etc., put additional unnecessary axiom for this because they struggle with second Rademeister move going in the opposite direction. It's not needed. You can work with braids. Still balancing is needed, so I'm saying not really. It's not really the end. Okay. So now let's go back to homology, but maybe first I will draw here a few examples. Maybe I will just draw for because it's easy to draw for Jones polynomial. So for Jones polynomial, the matrix is 4 by 4 because V is two-dimensional. V, I don't know, span of E0, E1, two-dimensional span. So I cannot draw immediately, so it will be deformation of just switch. Then I can remember Q, 0, 0, plus some small weights. So 0, 0, 1, so here will be switch. Okay. So maybe first one, right here 1, just doing nothing. So this is just coloring like this. A, B, B, A. Not very interesting. And now we deform this. So deformation will be here Q. I'm writing this deformation which Jones used. And here will be Q minus Q. So what is important? That this operator has minimal polynomial of degree 2. One can check. And then it is giving scale relation of the salt Q square link with positive crossing minus Q to minus 2 link with negative crossing is equal Q minus Q inverse when you smooth this. So when you know this, it's not very difficult to check that this is leading to Jones polynomial. I wrote in these variables because generalization have here higher power of Q. So this is kind of level. We say M equal to, here should be M, M equal to. Okay, so I will play with this matrix later. Now let's go back to homology, but slightly more carefully. So I will keep definition which is here, di and di left and di right. But we see that we have trouble with, in very general case, with presimplicial precubic set. So the solution, and this is solution, so it is independently my work and Victoria Lebert, but he went maybe nicer. The thing probably for physicists standard is to put here a wall, some n on which Quandl act. And here a wall will be on other side, but I will concentrate on other side. So there will be m left, m right. So this will not disappear, but it will interact with wall. So what will be this interaction with wall? What is our goal? Let's concentrate on left side. So I will write only half of the axiom. Will be di dj. Let's concentrate on the left side. Must be equal dj di minus 1 or I less than j. So this will hold inside due to Braid relation and Yang-Baxter relation. But on the boundary, it is not so nice. So let's see what happened on the boundary. So let's consider this just the closest to the boundary. D1, D2 must be equal D1, D1. So this is this additional condition which, I should write Victoria Lebert name. So condition is easy. To achieve this is difficult, so she didn't have any examples except that this is a disappear. But still, this is proper condition, absolutely proper condition, as I will write in a moment. So let's write somehow this interaction. So this is map ML tensor V into ML. So it is disappearing on the wall.
Maybe we have 5 more minutes.
Sorry?
Maybe we have 5 more minutes.
Whatever, yeah. If there's no T. Ah, because Oleg will. Yeah.
No problem.
So I think it's formally 25, yeah? At least what I was told.
Oh.
1.5. But anyway, I can finish soon because everybody can see the definition.
Yes, fine. The talk should finish including questions by 3:30.
Oh,
so
yes,
fine. Yeah.
No, I can finish. Then I don't have to prove anything. But this I will write the only computational element I will do. So what happened here? What is the picture? We go, remember, we go from right to left. It's like all these conditions for I less than G is that we start first this, then this. So we do D2, crossing, and D1. And this should be equal D1, D1. So we need this axiom. So here is R, and here is this interaction with the wall. I can have some name, but I have this function here. Maybe we should call this somehow. R wall. So we need such axioms, which means that this should be chosen, that this holds. But let's see what happens when we don't have wall, because I said that calculation I was able to do, and anyway, how to guess this map is maybe not for specialists, maybe this easy, but for me not. Let's see what means that special case, which I consider. The wall can be ignored. What it means that M left is just our ring, and the map, this R wall, is sending this case, so has identity tensor any x is just 1. This is meaning of disappearing, just putting 1. So what it means now, this axiom? It means that here I'm getting just for every a and b 1, and here I'm getting r. So I'm getting sum, let's say, for every A and B, so sum over C D R A B C D, this would be just one. What it means? It means that when we properly distinguish which are rows, which are columns, let's say that AB is fixed here, RAB, and here will be CD, which means that this sum adds to 1. So I will assume this stochastic condition. I mean, it's not really stochastic, it's just column unital, because I don't have any assumption about positivity, but stochastic sounds better. So I will assume that this is 1, and then homology is defined automatically by this assumption that here we put R, and this is just disappearing. So my previous definition works, and on the boundary we need this condition, if boundary is just the ring and nothing happened. So with this assumption, let's compute homology. So let's do this. It does not satisfy condition that columns add to 1. So naively, let's deform this by deforming every, adding these numbers and dividing column by this number. So what we get? Of course, here we just 1. Here we have to divide, so let's put y. My student put y squared, so I'm putting after him 1 squared. It's 1. What is the sum here? It is 1 plus q minus q inverse, so this is my y squared. So here will be y squared, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, and here if you compute it will be probably 1 minus y squared. Okay. So this is just deformation from the blue, because I didn't know anything. Maybe after some thinking it should work. But I asked students to check by computer this and other levels of Homply polynomial. And amazingly, this is Yang-Baxter operator as well. I mean, it's not so amazing. I think this balancing coefficients satisfy some cocycle thing, and there's a reason. But if you do this for two-variable Kaufman polynomial and take the standard Yang-Baxter equation giving this, this normalization will not lead to Yang-Baxter operator, at least what student told me. So this is special thing, Jones or generalized Jones. So now let's finish with calculation we did. So our ring is a ring of now of polynomial of variable y, maybe y squared, but doesn't matter. K equal z y squared. Here it's not clear, probably I should allow negative powers as well. Okay, so what we get? And this is interesting, but we don't know really good reasons. So my student did calculation for this case, and he got that any homology, he computed up to 10, this Yang-Baxter homology. So it is level 2. Yang-Baxter 2. Anyway, m equal 2. This is equal some free part. He wrote it precisely, but again, related to Fibonacci numbers, standard Fibonacci numbers, but I don't make sense of this, so I don't know. Y squared to some power plus, there are two torsion pieces. Why I write y squared? You can write over y with less writing. 1 minus y squared to some power plus z of y minus y to the fourth power, and again to some power. So we are able to guess this. So I should give his name because it's exclusive his computer calculation, Xiao Wang. Okay. So the only, so this is already spring of this year. So the only new calculation, this is, like I say, slow progress, because I was working on, really on this homology of Alexander Quandl. The only progress is that I decided to compute precisely second homology, but not only for this, but for Yang-Baxter operator corresponding to Homfli in general. And this is kind of laborious but rather easy calculation, but you don't need computers. Oh, this was still needed, sorry. This was my last comment, so draw again. So, theorem. So, okay, this is my student and me. Second homology, this Yang-Baxter homology of Rm. So level m. If you think about relation, instead of 2, we take m. This is giving Homfli polynomial for this concrete substitution. So what it is? So it has these three pieces. Of course, I don't remember now which is which. I should remember it. Okay. Of course, there are these pieces, but now I write precisely powers. So it is z y to power 1 plus n choose 2. I hope. Not m, m level. It's on the second homology. M choose 2 plus z of y divided by 1 minus y squared to power just m choose 2 plus the last piece z of y 1 minus 4th power to power just m minus 1. So second homology is still relatively easy to compute. But what it means, I have no clue, because I said we should look at this and look at Hovanov homology at C connections. The problem is that this is just homology of operator, and Hovanov homology, of course, is for diagrams. So let me finish with one mysterious picture, how to put diagrams here. Of course, the main thing I said, we look for cycle or cocycle invariants, decorating diagram and taking two entries. So I will finish with mysterious picture which explains that essentially Tertra-de-Meister move works well. Oh, I don't need this. I was supposed to modify these pictures. But before I draw a picture, let's write abstractly general definition once more, but only for third differential. So for A, B, C, it is equal. Remember, it was this cubic structure, so I will just write by definition. So sum from 1 to 3 differences of left and right. So what it will be? Just the easiest thing is to just write as definitions say, d1l minus d1 right minus d2 left minus d2 right plus d3 left minus d3 right. So this is just abstract definition, and then we have this graphical interpretation, what you mean left going to left, right going to right. And look at the third Rademeister move. And remembering that I'm trying to catch, when you have positive crossing, I have only positive gel, I will try to catch the spell. Okay. So let me do once more, sorry. Let's erase these unnecessary things. Nothing is needed. Okay. So, we are studying levels just before crossing, because this is bringing our differential. I mean, our cocycle, whatever it is, this pairs. Let's see that it works. Sorry, before, not after. Okay, now look carefully. We are interested in these two numbers. What happened with this? We can say that this has just disappeared because it's not involved here. So here we are just taking, of course we're taking these two numbers, but it will be, first of all, this is going to right, so this is dr, this is the third. But that's so far so kind of trivial. Here, we take weights here, and this is going to the left and disappear because it's not involved here. So this is called D2 left. What about this? This is involved, this disappears. It is going on the bottom till the end. So it is right and the first. See, the positive terms from this. And here similarly. Here the first is going to left and disappear. Here, of course, the second is going right and disappear. And finally, this here, what we do, this is third, and this is going from third position to the left. Okay. And to have invariants of this naive pairs invariant, this should be equal to this. So, this to be equal to this, D3R plus D2 left plus D1 right should be equal to D1 left, D2 right plus D3 left. This is exactly this, if I didn't make a mistake, of course. This is the first step of proving that we can construct, in fact, two chain which is invariant, homologically invariant under third Rademeister. Essentially, this is enough. But as I said, slow progress, I didn't have time to go further. But you can construct at least modulo third Rademeister move, and I think second is very easy with orientation, invariant of links, two-cycle or two-cycle from every Yang-Baxter operator, which is columned unital, or maybe you can force this to be column unital if you are lucky. So, thank you.
Questions? Do you think expect that Yang-Baxter homology is going to be homology of some topological spaces, at least in special cases?
For set theoretical, of course, because it's already cubic realization, pre-cubic realization of this. But for general Yang-Baxter, I don't know. This is like your homology. Geometric realization came much later. Now we think it's not that difficult, but because it's neither cubic, non-simplicial, some mixture, so one have to think. And here even more, yeah, because there's more terms potential. However, for John's polynomial, no, there are only two terms, so it's not so bad.
So do you get the Kolmogorov polynomial?
Sorry?
Do you get the Kolmogorov polynomial from
You mean homology? With Hovanov homology, I see no relation except when you go to the bottom, Jones polynomial or Homfli polynomial, but not on homological level, no. There are still objects of different sorts. This is homology theory for operators, and you need to do this for diagrams. This is the first step, that you do it for diagrams and the same Yang-Baxter operation from Jones polynomial, but each diagram is giving different thing. But this is on the second homology. So I think I can do for third with this shadows, but it's still, I don't know.
Joseph, and can I ask you about quantals? So you explained that if you have a quantal, you can build an R matrix.
You can build?
An R matrix from a quantal.
Oh, yeah, very easy one.
But inverse is not correct, yeah?
I think no, because one is linear combination and one is just set theoretical mixing basis, so no. On the other hand, in Notting Hill, Jones was trying to convince us that from set theoretical you can do something much more interesting, taking some subspaces, mixing them, and doing something, which I didn't understand. So, but he said that you can do sometimes going from not set theoretical back to set theoretical.
But is there any understanding of what kind of R matrices you can get in this way? Or probably what is the restriction or whatever, yeah? What is the additional property?
I think there's no restriction.
No, but
any set theoretical Yang-Baxter equation can get kind of, because everything is producing link invariant. I'm not sure I understand the question, so.
Yeah, but if I have some R matrix,
yeah.
Can I find the quantum which reproduces it?
No. No.
So it means that there can be obstacles, yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Looking at our metrics, you can judge.
Oh, yeah, absolutely right. Because we have given basis, and for me, but you can change basis, and maybe you say in different basis it behaves better.
Of course, maybe
yeah.
Everything.
I don't know.
Is it known what this.
No, I don't think so.
I see. Sorry. That's
especially not for me, Yang-Baxter, the general Yang-Baxter operator is a miracle. I ask you, and you tell me, give me Yang-Baxter operator, and I can use it. No, I don't know how to get them. I look at some papers in old time, Jimbo, Baxter.
No, there are some standard sets from group theory you can get just a big set of R matrices, definitely, yes.
But they are set theoretic or general?
General.
Yeah. General, okay. I know from every representation you can get Yang-Baxter operator. And to get invariant of links is almost natural because it satisfies some minimal equation. It's enough to take characteristic, usually polynomial. And
but your main argument is that if you have a quantal, you can build a homology theory.
Oh, yeah.
But for generic R matrix, it's unclear how to do it.
Oh, I define. Mm-hmm. So either you say that you have these additional axioms, or you have to assume that columns are 2-1. But yes, there is general construction. With invariant of links, that's more problematic. But
I think that at least they should be monomial.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean this.
Such matrices. Yeah.
They can be conjugated.
Well, if they just directly obtained from that, they are monomial, and moreover, the entries are just variables. Simple thing.
Yeah, but as Renat says, that's not quite answers the question, yeah, because you can get more. But the belief, you would say that the quantals are much smaller, yeah?
Oh, generally, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if they keep one,
mm-hmm.
one parameter. You can change bases and will not keep it. But even by quantal or whatever, the set theoretic, I think they are very limited. However, Jones claimed that from set theoretic he can get Jones polynomial. He hopes.
Did you say he hopes or he?
No, hopes.
But then the claim is that this is a much narrower set, but still it has some.
A lot of information,
yeah. And once again, what are the advantages?
You can compute. For example, Alexander Quandl, I computed second homology, which is needed for cocycle invariant. So concretely, the simplest cocycle will be just sending two chains into homology. And because homology is almost exterior algebra, then it's very easy object to work. When here I have no clue, computer is helping, but maybe no, second homology I could compute, but I don't know. But I'm here just, I hope, to learn what to do, especially with this wall. I remember the first time similar talk, maybe not almost similar, I gave in Stony Brook, or anywhere, in Simon's Institute. And then I asked, what parameters are unchanged when you hit the wall? Because this equation which I got is clearly some conservation law. But I don't know physics, so I can only imagine energy and...
What is your motivation for that boundary condition?
Oh, because then it is simply pre-cubic set. My boundary operations are giving pre-cubic set if this is equal.
I didn't understand that.
So remember, the goal was to have, let's say only from the left, DIL was this. But really it should be this, because cannot disappear totally, then we lose. So this is our DIL, and then we like equation DI DJ, let's say only from left side, is equal to DJ minus 1 DI, or I less than J. So you check this equation, and if you take D, yeah, as I wrote there, it's maybe still there, D2 D1, D1 D2, D1 D2, must be equal to D1 D1. And when you write this and draw a picture, you get exactly this equation. But this equation kind of trivially holds if you assume that matrix is column unital. Yeah. Which often happens. Not often, because even for John's polynomial Yang-Baxter equation, you had to make additional flattening, but it worked.
Let's save the remaining questions for after the talk, and thank you, Joseph.